by grace can we enter. Only by grace can we stand. Not by our human endeavor, but by the blood of the Lamb. Into your presence you call us, you call us to come. Into your presence you draw us, and now by your grace we come. Now by your grace we come. Lord, if you mark our transgressions, who would stand? Thanks to your grace we are cleansed by the blood of the Lamb. Lord, if you mark our transgressions, who would stand? Thanks to your grace we are cleansed by the blood of the Lamb. Only by grace can we enter. Only by grace can we stand. Not by our human endeavor, but by the blood of the Lamb. Into your presence you call us, you call us to come. Into your presence you draw us, and now by your grace we come. Now by your grace we come.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our Facebook Live service this morning. It's good to have you sharing with us wherever you are joining us from. It sounds like it's very wet and windy everywhere this morning. It's certainly very wet and windy here in Goole. And we've had a post from Bridget saying that it's very wet and windy in Selby, and a very wet and windy morning in Newark as well, so Jean tells us. But whatever the weather, it's good to be here, and it's good that God is with us in the quiet of our homes as we gather together for this virtual act of worship. And so as we gather, we hear some words of the psalmist from Psalm 24. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. For he founded it on the seas and established it on the waters. Who may ascend the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? The one who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not trust in an idol or swear by a false god. They will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from God their Saviour. Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seek your face, God of Jacob. So today is the day that we call All Saints Sunday, the Sunday in the Christian calendar nearest to All Saints Day, which is of course tomorrow. And so we join our hearts and our voices with those of the saints and the angels in heaven in declaring God's praise as we sing our first hymn, Ye Holy Angels Bright, Who Wait at God's Right Hand. It's 69 if you're singing from Singing the Faith. Ye Holy Angels Bright.
Ye Holy Angels Bright, who wait at God's right hand, who through the realms of light fly at your Lord's command. Us is the loom, or else the theme to hide us in, for am little Tom. He blesses souls at rest, who ran this earthly race. Born now from sin released, behold your Saviour's face. His praises sung, as in his sight with sweet delight ye do abound. He says, below, adore your heavenly King, and onward as ye go, some joyful anthem sing. Take what he gives, and praise him still through good and ill, forever lives. My soul, bear thou the part, triumph in God above, and with a well-tuned heart sing round the songs of love. Let all thy days, till I shall end whate'er he send, be filled with praise.
Let us pray. Loving and gracious God, we join our hearts and voices with those of the saints and angels in heaven in declaring your praise and in proclaiming that you are God, worthy of all worship and blessing, glory and honour. We join together in spirit with Christian people the world over in proclaiming that Jesus Christ is Lord, and we bow before him, our Saviour and King. We pray that your Holy Spirit will inspire our worship, that we may praise you with the zeal of those who worship before your throne in heaven. We seek your forgiveness, because we have not always expressed the kind of humility which befits those called to be counted amongst your people. We have put our wants and desires before the needs of others and have ignored the cry of the poor and the despairing. Forgive us, we pray, and recreate us in the image of Christ your Son, who died for us and who rose to life, that we may anticipate the life of heaven, where with all your saints we will praise and serve you for ever. Amen. So Ellen's going to read two short Bible passages, which are two of the readings for this All Saints Sunday. Firstly, from the book of the Old Testament book of the prophet Isaiah, and then from the Revelation of St. John the Divine.
Reading from Isaiah chapter 25, verses 6 to 9. On this mountain, the Lord Almighty will prepare a feast of rich food for all peoples, a banquet of aged wine, the best of meats and the finest of wines. On this mountain, he will destroy the shroud that enfolds all peoples, the sheet that covers all nations. He will swallow up death forever. The Sovereign Lord will wipe away the tears from all faces. He will remove his people's disgrace from all the earth. The Lord has spoken. In that day they will say, "Surely this is our God. We trusted in him, and he saved us. This is the Lord. We trusted in him. Let us rejoice and be glad in his salvation." And from Revelation chapter 21, verses 1 to 6. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. He who is seated on the throne said, I am making everything new. Then he said, write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. He said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end.
I long to be where the praise is never ending, yearn to dwell where the glory never fades, where countless worshippers will share one song and cries of worthy will honour the Lamb. All my days I will sing this song of gladness. Number Savior, wonderful counselor.
history. You're the way, the truth, the life, star of the morning. Glorious in holiness, you're the risen one, heaven's champion, and you reign, you reign over all.
The gospel reading is one of those readings that doesn't really make a lot of sense unless you give some context to it. So I'll tell you that it's part of the very familiar story of the raising of Lazarus. So Ellen's going to read from John's Gospel, chapter 11.
So, St. John's Gospel, chapter 11, verses 32-44. When Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and in trouble. "Where have you laid him?" he asked. "Come and see, Lord," they replied. Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. "Take away the stone," he said. "But Lord," said Martha, the sister of the dead man, "by this time there is a bad odour, for he has been there for 4 days. Then Jesus said, "Did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me." Then he said this. When he said this, Jesus called in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen, and a cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, "Take off the grave clothes and let him go."
I'm sure that you don't need me to remind you that today is Halloween. Like me, you'll have seen over this past couple of weeks an abundance of pumpkins, houses and gardens garishly or even gruesomely decorated. And this evening we'll all be hoping that our doorbells aren't rung by the dreaded trick-or-treaters. It's all very far removed from the origins of Halloween, because for Christians, today is All Hallows' Eve, or the Eve of All Saints' Day, in the same way that Christmas Eve is the day before Christmas Day. The way in which Christian traditions have been secularised in our society may be amongst those things which cause us to ask, can things possibly get any worse? Or will things ever get any better? The latter is a question which we may well have asked quite often over the past 18 months or so. We may still be asking the question today as we hear of around 40,000 new COVID infections every day, about 8,000 people in hospital with COVID, and the threat of certain restrictions having to be imposed if the situation doesn't soon start to improve. But it's not just COVID that causes us to ask, will things ever get any better? Again, as you will know, the COP26 climate change conference begins in Glasgow the day after tomorrow. And while we hope and even pray that decisions will be taken that will really make a difference and that delegates to the conference will go home and do something, there's a part of us that feels a bit like the Queen when she was overheard to say, it's really irritating when they talk but don't do. When we look at the state of our world and see the effects of climate change, we may well ask, will things ever get any better? And what about our own society, where every day there are stabbings and murders, where domestic violence is on the increase, and where the provision for the neediest and most vulnerable is so often inadequate? Will things ever get any better? Or can they possibly get any worse? There are questions we may also have asked ourselves, or which we may have heard others ask during a difficult time or a painful period in their lives. A time of bereavement, a time of severe illness, a time of crisis. And these questions may well have been found on the lips of those who feature in two of today's Bible readings for the Sunday nearest to All Saints' Day. The Old Testament reading from Isaiah is set at a time when the Jewish people were being held as captives in Babylon. Their homeland had been destroyed, their freedom had been lost. There were times when they found themselves asking, will things ever get any better? Or can things possibly get any worse? Some of the Psalms belong to this period in Jewish history. For example, Psalm 137, where the people lament, by the waters of Babylon we sat down and wept when we remembered Zion. How shall we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? As I said, the Gospel reading was part of the story of the raising of Lazarus. His sisters, Mary and Martha, who clearly felt that had Jesus been there, he could have prevented the death, must have wondered, like many bereaved people, if things could possibly get any worse. Whilst the Israelite people held in captivity in Babylon sometimes found themselves falling into despair, the passage we heard today from Isaiah suggests that they also clung to the hope of a better and brighter tomorrow. They looked forward to a time when they would be set free from captivity, and when they would celebrate what God had done for them. The passage pictures a great party on Mount Zion in Jerusalem, when all the nations would gather to celebrate because God had given victory to his people. I wonder if you noticed a common thread running through the three readings. That common thread was victory over death. In the Old Testament, there are actually very few references to victory over death and to eternal life, but one of them is found in Isaiah 25, as we heard this morning. He will swallow up death forever. The writer of Revelation pictures a time when God will bring about a new creation in which death will be no more. And the story of the raising of Lazarus points to Jesus as the one who can raise the dead. The story is sometimes seen as pointing to Jesus' own resurrection, confirming the ultimate victory over death. It's been described as a sort of dress rehearsal for the resurrection of Jesus himself. So these readings are significant for All Saints Sunday inasmuch as the saints we celebrate today are those who have overcome death and who now share in the life of heaven. Perhaps we should pause to ask what we exactly mean when we talk about the saints. I guess that we immediately think of people like St. Peter and St. Paul and so on. In the early years of the Christian Church, those who had been martyred for their faith or who had made a particular contribution to the Church's life and work were made saints after they had died. And each saint had his or her own day, which was the day on which they died and on which they were commemorated in future years. Over a period of time, there were far too many saints for each of them to be commemorated individually, so All Saints' Day became a day on which to remember all the saints collectively. The word saint, however, has a different slant when it's used in the New Testament. If you look at the opening verses of some of St. Paul's letters, he writes such things as, "To all in Rome who are loved by God and called to be saints. To all the saints in Christ Jesus who are at Philippi. To the saints and faithful brethren in Christ at Colossae." So, in the New Testament, the title saints is a title for Christians generally. Now, we might not feel particularly comfortable with that because we tend to use the word saint in a different way, more often than not to describe somebody who we think of as being particularly good, and we may not put ourselves in that category. But for all that, in a biblical sense, the word saints applies to all Christian believers. If we understand the word saint as applying to all Christians, then this Sunday is a day for celebrating the lives of those who have been saints on earth and who now share in the life of heaven. The experience of the saints on earth has often been akin to the experience of those people who featured in the Bible readings from Isaiah and St. John's Gospel. Just as the Jewish people of Isaiah's day found themselves as captives in a strange land, wondering if and when things would ever get any better, so in every generation there have been those Christians whose faith has been tested and who have found themselves the victims of persecution. Even for individuals, being people of faith doesn't mean that we are in any way immune from the difficulties and indeed the tragedies of human life. Just as Mary in the story of Lazarus said, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." And the people with her asked, "Could not he who opened the eyes of a blind man have kept this man from dying?" So we may have questioned why we have had to experience tragedy and why our prayers have not been answered in those ways that we've longed for them to be. It sometimes seems to have been the case that those who have lived closest to God and whose lives have been most saintly in the sense of reflecting the light and the love of God are the ones who've had to suffer the most, rather like Job in the Old Testament. Sometimes they've been able to hold on to a quiet trust in God, but at other times they've been overwhelmed by a sense of desolation and abandonment. Using the word saint in its narrower sense, someone like Terry Waite, whose story is well known, might be counted amongst the saints of recent decades. A man who was prepared to risk his own safety and well-being in order to work for peace and reconciliation in a troubled part of the world. If you've read his book, Taken on Trust, you'll know that during his imprisonment, there were times when his faith brought him comfort and hope, but there were also times when he felt completely abandoned. In our lesser crises, perhaps there's a sense in which we drift between one and the other. Times when our faith brings us comfort and hope, but also times when we feel that sense of abandonment. The story of Lazarus speaks to us of the reality of death and the accompanying sense of grief and loss which comes from it. We would be less than human if, like Mary, we didn't feel a sense of grief and loss at the death of a loved one. But the ultimate hope of the saints is the hope of victory over death. And the story of Lazarus points to that. Earlier in the story, Jesus is heard to say, "I am the resurrection and the life. They who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die." The passage from Revelation spoke of a time when death will be no more. So often as Christians, we affirm our hope of the life to come. And yet, as I frequently say at funeral services, it's a life we cannot begin to comprehend or even imagine. Today, we celebrate all those saints who share in that life and with whom we believe we are united in some mysterious way through what we call the communion of saints. That's the belief that Christ's followers on earth are joined with his followers in heaven. Whilst the raising of Lazarus points to Jesus' ultimate victory over death, and whilst we look forward to sharing in the life of heaven and to the time when death will be no more, we need to remember that Lazarus was raised to live again, at least for a time in this world. You may be familiar with the Christian Aid slogan, "We believe in life before death." We believe in life before death. Inspired by their faith in Jesus, saints on earth have often worked for victory over those things which are destructive to human life and well-being. Things like injustice, poverty and oppression. They have sought to make things better and to bring to others a renewed quality of life in the here and now. Not life after death, but life before death. And certainly as saints on earth at the present time, we all have a responsibility to respond to the challenges of climate change and to consider what small part we might play in protecting the planet and caring for the earth and its resources. All of us, as the saints of God, are called to play our part in establishing the values of God's kingdom in the world. We pray so often, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." As we celebrate the life of the saints in heaven, so we pray that we may live faithfully as God's saints here on earth, and that we may both pray and work for the coming of his kingdom. We're all very familiar with the hymn, "For all the saints who from their labours rest," but in Singing the Faith, there's a kind of more modern version of the same, well, it's not a modern version of the same hymn, it's a contemporary hymn which expresses the same sentiment. I think that's a more accurate way of describing it. It's a hymn from the Iona community by John Bell and Graham Maul, "For all the saints who showed your love." So we're going to sing that now. It's 7:46, and it's sung to the folk tune "O Waly Waly," which I'm sure you'll recognise. "For all the saints who showed your love in how they lived and where they moved, for mindful women, caring men, accept our gratitude again."
For all the saints who showed your love in how they your will selfless protest, prayer and praise, accept the gratitude we raise. Bless all whose will or name or love reflects the grace of heaven above, though unattained by earthly powers, your life through theirs has hallowed us.
Come now to our prayers, which follow the theme that we've been looking at this morning. So let's pray together. God of life, victorious over death, we remember with thanksgiving those Christians who have gone before us and who now share in the life of heaven. Those saints of old who first established the church and who faithfully proclaim the good news that others may believe. Those great leaders and thinkers who spoke and taught, wrote and recorded, so that Christians of future generations could read, learn and grow in understanding. Those who throughout the centuries have been martyred rather than deny their faith in Christ. We pray that we may follow their example as we work for the coming of your kingdom. God of life, victorious over death, we remember with thanksgiving those Christians who have helped, influenced and inspired us in our own faith and discipleship. Those who taught us in Sunday school or nurtured us in our youth. Those who gave good and compassionate pastoral care. Those who preached in ways that inspired and excited us. Those through whose quiet yet sincere witness we were helped to see your love and to encounter the person of Jesus Christ. We pray that we may have their dedication in our own discipleship, that others may see your love in us. God of life, victorious over death, we remember the saints of this present age, your church throughout the world, and we pray especially for those for whom discipleship is challenging or costly. We pray that you will give to your people the courage to speak out where there is suffering and injustice, and to act in ways that testify to the truth and the compassion of the gospel. We thank you for those who are speaking out about the effects of climate change and particularly its impact on the world's poorest communities. And we pray for the COP26 climate conference in Glasgow this week, that words will be translated into action. We pray too for the G20 summit meeting in Rome, that world leaders may work together for the good of all. God of life, victorious over death, we remember with thanksgiving those who have recently died, and we pray for all who mourn and grieve, that they may be comforted and sustained. May the Christian hope of being raised to new and eternal life through faith in Christ comfort them in their grief. We pray for all for whom life is hard for whatever reason, and for those who have lost the will to live, for all who are unwell, and for those who have become exhausted by caring for a loved one who is ill or who has ongoing needs. We pray that they may look to you and draw from you those life-giving resources which you alone can give. Now a time of quiet to bring our own particular needs and prayers to God, and as usual, if you want to share prayer concerns so that we can support you in praying this morning. Our prayers we offer in and through the name of Jesus, who conquered death for us, and through whom we receive the gift of new and eternal life. Amen. And we share in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We will be back next week for our Facebook live worship, but as you probably saw from my post on Facebook, from next week we're just going to be doing the live stream service on from home on the first Sunday of the month. So next Sunday is a first Sunday, so we'll start the new pattern, as it were, from next Sunday, and then it will just be on the first Sunday of the month. There are some Sundays during Advent, particularly when I've got three services in churches on a Sunday, and I just think it's going to be a bit too much to keep up the Facebook service every week as well. And also, as you know, we are hoping to have more of our services from Portone Church streamed regularly. It's just occasionally at the moment, but we're hoping to build on that, and for that to be every week. So if it happens one week that the Portone service is going to be streamed on the first Sunday of the month, then obviously I won't do, or we won't do the service from home. We'll move that to another Sunday. But it will all be on my Facebook page and on the Portone Church Facebook page. So hopefully you'll get the information that you need. So we will be back next Sunday, and from there, the most likely the first Sunday of the month, but with some flexibility depending on what happens with the stream services from Portone Church. But I know people still continue to value these services. Obviously more people are getting back into their church buildings now, so we don't have so many sharing in the service. I see we've got 23 at the moment, and probably those will be joining in later on. So it'd be good to keep our virtual congregation together, even if we don't actually meet every week. So as I say, that's the pattern, and I hope you'll be happy with that. That kind of compromise, which I think is probably the best I can offer at the present time. So look forward to being back with you next week. But we haven't finished yet, because we've got another hymn to sing, and this is one of my favourites of the more contemporary hymns. I first sang this at at our district synod when I first came to the Yorkshire North and East District in September of 2018, and we sang it at the synod, and it was one that I'd never heard before, and I immediately liked it, and it's one that I've been able to introduce to our virtual services. So it's number 337. There is a higher throne than all this world of know. There is a higher throne than all this world has known, where faithful ones from every tongue will one day come. And the words, some of the words, are based on the passage from Revelation that we heard earlier. There is a higher throne. There is a higher throne than all this world has known, where faithful ones from every tongue will one day come. Before our God will stand, made faultless through the land, believing hearts find promised grace, salvation comes. Hear heaven's voices ring, their wondrous anthem rings through emerald courts and sapphire skies, their praises rise. All glory, wisdom, power, strength, thanks and honour are to God our King, who reigns on high forevermore. And there we'll find our home, our life before the throne. We'll honour him in perfect song, where we belong. He'll wipe each tear stained eye, as thirst and hunger die. The Lamb becomes our Shepherd King, we'll reign with him. Hear heaven's voices sing, their thunderous anthem rings through emerald courts and sapphire skies, their praises rise. All glory, wisdom, power, strength, thanks and honour are to God our King, who reigns on high forevermore. Hear heaven's voices sing, their thunderous anthem rings to emerald courts and sapphire skies, their praises rise. All glory, wisdom, power, strength, thanks and honour are to God our King, who reigns on high forevermore. Thank you for the lovely comments that are coming up. It's really good to know how much these services have been appreciated, and it's been a real privilege to be able to do them. But we've not finished yet, and hope those of you who are sending these lovely messages will still be able to share with us when we have our monthly service, as I say, mostly on the first Sunday of the month. But we're back next week, so we'll look forward to sharing with you then. So let's bless each other wherever we are as we share in the words of the grace. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. I tell you, we're blubbering wrecks here. Thank you all. Have a good week, whatever you're doing. God bless you. And thank you for your love and support. And, you know, It's just been a real blessing. But we haven't finished. I'm making it sound as though we've finished, but we're back next week. And then, as I say, the first Sunday of the month. Thank you. Bye.